Hello, and welcome back to another 2XL Tuesday. This week we have Challenges of General Science, which looks like it has been run through a washing machine. This tape is very, very bubbly, and this label has definitely gotten very wet at some point, which is a shame because it's one of the, I think it's the only tape I have actually that has a label on the front and on the back. For some reason, these tapes that have the label on the back are much harder to find, I guess just for manufacturing reasons or whatever. It was cheaper to just not include this, but basically all the back label is just an advertisement for more tapes. That's literally it. Ask for them at the store or write 2XL Tapes, P.O. Box 999, Northfield, New Jersey, 07647. I want to send a letter to that P.O. Box and see what happens. It'll probably just get sent back to me, but whatever. Write them and be like, hey, I want a 2XL tape, and they'll be like, what? Anyway, Challenges of General Science. This program explores the fascinating world of Earth science, astronomy, chemistry, and simple physics. Magnetism, volcanoes, eclipses, and weather are just a few areas 2XL introduces and explains, in his own special way. And this tape is from 1981, so one of the later ones. Again, with the artwork being a mishmash of various things, there's a generic scientist-looking man in the middle holding a beaker. I assume the beaker has some sort of a science-y thing in it. There's a bunch of symbols inside of circles that I don't recognize. I think the one with the C is the copyright symbol. I have no idea what the rest of these are. It's just lines and squigglies and things I've never seen these before in my life. There's a light bulb. Oh, that's a recreation of the original light bulb. Interesting. There's a little, like, I think that's a nucleus with atoms around it. There's a little thing with some phases of the moon. Cloud and lightning. There's a sun on here. There's some, like, autumn leaves that are falling into a pond. Oh, gosh, what else is on here? There's a ton of stuff. I'm probably going to miss some things. There's a lady holding a pencil directly below the scientist man, and an assortment of various, like, beakers and containers and, yeah, science-y things. And, yes, there is a name attributed to this artwork, Sally B. Hidden in the corner there. There's our friend Sally. But, yeah, let's pop this tape in. Oh, and this one does have a button relabel thingy. So, what is different? Oh, okay, so the first button is question and true. The second button is A and yes, which is the same. The third button is B and no, which is different. And the last button is C and false, which is the same, so. So interesting, they just moved yes and no around. And true also, but yeah.
Thank you for turning me on. I am your friendly little robot, 2XL, and this program is entitled General Science. You will be happy to know there are two programs on the tape in my belly. If you would like to hear the first program, push A. If you would prefer the second program, push B. Please push A or B now.
Okay, keeping with tradition, we're going to go with the first program. Oh, I guess it was already on track A. Okay, nothing happened when I pushed the button. That was weird.
Oh, good. Please remember two things. One, relabel my buttons with the card enclosed.
Got
and
it.
Two, only choose answers after I say the word. Now, three, I've decided to add one.
Oh, okay.
Always follow my instructions. No fooling around. Follow my instructions to the letter.
Okay.
Question number one. If you could dig 20 miles down into the earth, you would find that all of the rock is liquid. That's right, liquid. Is this true or false? Answer now.
20 miles. I think that's true. I think that's where the magma layer of the
you
Earth is.
You have answered true, and you must be a genius or something, because Yay. You are right. Here is the scoop. The crust of the Earth is about 5 miles thick and contains the type of rock you see on mountains. When you go down about 20 miles, you get to the part of the Earth called the mantle, as in Mickey Mantle. This mantle
Who?
Is so hot.
I guess that's
liquid.
Someone who was famous
it
in the 80s and 70s.
Rock, and the entire center of the Earth is liquid. By the way, a volcano is where the liquid rock from the mantle shoots up through the volcano tube and comes out of the Earth as lava. Lava is molten or melted rock that comes from the mantle of the Earth. Question number 2. True or false? An earthquake is when a giant mountain sinks into the Earth, and it causes the Earth to sink with it. Answer true or false now.
No, that is not true. Earthquakes are the tectonic plates shifting.
I, 2XL, am
Whoa.
Very impressed.
Loud.
You have answered false, and false is right, and this was a hard question. Good. An earthquake is when the crust of the Earth breaks. Or actually snaps. Now, if you think about it, the crust of the Earth is really quite thin. Maybe, as I said, 5 miles thick. But the Earth is 8,000 miles thick. And that means that the crust is like an eggshell. And if you crack an eggshell, then it begins to move. And that's exactly what happens in an earthquake. An earthquake is where this little thin crust, relatively speaking, begins to crack or snap. And the Earth actually moves. Earthquakes are extremely dangerous. Once in China, an earthquake, which isn't easy. I don't even have a tongue. Let's begin again. Once in China, an earthquake killed 830,000 people. If you are ever in an earthquake, try to get outside as soon as possible. An open field away from buildings is the safest place to be. I now need
I like
a favor.
Eggshell
Please
analogy.
Push
that was nice.
The question. Button now.
Alright.
Question 3 will be a question about Detective Glubber.
Who?
You will use your knowledge
knowledge.
To figure out what the clues are to help Detective Glubber solve this crime.
Okay.
Listen.
I don't know who this
Detective
is, but...
Detective Glubber was sent to investigate a bank robbery that took place right next door to his police station. Upon arriving on the scene, Detective Glubber saw 3 things. 1, a large steel door to the vault in the bank had a large hole blown right through it. 2, an old type war cannon that appeared to have blown the hole through the vault door. 3, a box of 5-second fuses used to fire this type of cannon. Ordinarily in use, each fuse would be lit with a match, and 5 seconds later, it would fire the cannon. Detective Glubber also knows that there was a storm last night, centered 5 miles away in Cavalry. So, it was possible that nobody heard the cannon go off because they thought it was thunder from the storm. However, since it took the cannon 5 seconds to fire once lit, the crooks or perpetrators, as I like to say, could not have fired once the thunderclap began, because that would have made the cannon go off after the thunderclap was over. Furthermore, Detective Glubber knows of no way the thieves could have predicted the exact moment of the thunderclap so as to light the fuse just before. Detective Glubber is confused. Please turn me off and figure out how you can help Detective Glubber. Turn me off now.
That's interesting and quite unexpected. And I'll be honest, I kind of stopped paying attention toward the end there. So, okay, there was a bank, there was a vault, a hole had been blown in the vault, There was a cannon. There was a thunderstorm. Is it possible that lightning struck the cannon, maybe, and caused it to fire? That's what I'm going to go with. Because lightning can strike from many miles away.
Here are three choices. Which do you think is most reasonable? A. The thieves used a silencer on the cannon.
No.
B. The thieves knew that thunder comes 5 seconds after lightning strikes when the storm is 5 miles away. C. The thieves soared through the vault with a hacksaw and used the cannon only as a decoy. Answer A, B, or C now.
Oh, I see what he's asking. Okay. Yeah. I'm gonna go with B, because they would have been able to
you
time...
You are so good at figuring things
yeah,
out.
Yeah, they would have been able to time the blast with
so
the thunder.
You
yeah.
are right. You
okay.
must be a
okay.
real genius. This is a hard question, and you are correct.
I feel bad for not
Here's
paying attention to that completely.
See, lightning travels so fast that it does get to the person who is looking at it almost instantaneously. Sound, on the other hand, travels relatively slow. And if you ever see lightning, and then you count the seconds to the time you hear thunder, you can approximate how far the storm is from where you are standing. So if you see lightning, and then 3 seconds later you hear thunder, the storm is about 3 miles away. And that's how Detective Glubber, with your help, could solve this problem. Because the thieves watched for lightning, and then, knowing where the storm was centered, figured out that it would take 5 seconds for the thunder to clap and lit the 5-second fuse. What they probably did is they got longer fuses, and when they saw that the storm was 5 miles away, they cut the fuses to 5 seconds in length.
Cool.
For question 4, I first have a question for you, a personal question. Do you know the difference between Fahrenheit and centigrade? Using my yes or no buttons, please answer me yes or no, now.
I'm going to say yes because I remember that from the tape a couple weeks ago.
That's good, but I'd like to test you for myself. It's not that I don't believe you or anything, but robots like to find out facts for themselves. So here we go.
That tape.
Question 4.
That was a metric system.
Which of these two statements is most correct? A. Water freezes at 0 degrees centigrade. Or B. Water freezes at 0 degrees Fahrenheit. Answer A or B now.
That is A. Oh, we're already on A. Okay. Yeah, water freezes at 0 centigrade.
Yahoo! Good answer. You are right. Water freezes at 0 degrees centigrade. Here's a fact you may want to write down. To convert centigrade to Fahrenheit, you multiply by 9/5. That's right, 9/5, and then add 32. To convert from Fahrenheit to centigrade, you subtract 32 and multiply by 5/9, which is the opposite, of course. And that will convert centigrade to Fahrenheit or Fahrenheit to centigrade. Here's an example. Let's assume we want to convert 212 degrees Fahrenheit, which is the temperature water boils at sea level. So following what I just said, we subtract 32 from 212. A quick robot computation equals 180. 180 times 5/9 equals a quick robot computation. Whoops, I think I sounded wrong. Let me do that again. A quick robot computation. There we go, equals 100. So 212 degrees Fahrenheit equals 100 degrees centigrade. Question 5. Changing the subject away from Earth science, here's your question. Another name for tooth decay is A, cavity, B, molar. Answer A or B now.
That's A, cavity. I was expecting there to be an option C, but no, we're going to leave it on A.
Cavity demonstrates you have wisdom teeth. You are right. Cavity is
I actually
another name
do
for
have
tooth
one wisdom
decay.
Tooth.
Here's a joke, yeah. Especially.
Yeah, fun fact. When I was a kid, I went to have my 4 wisdom teeth removed. And then cut to maybe 10-15 years later, I had just changed dentists. And, you know, they do the x-rays, and she's cleaning my teeth, and she goes, "So, you've had your wisdom teeth removed, right?" And I said, "Yeah." And she said, "They removed all four of them, right?" And I said, "Yeah." And she goes, "Why did they leave the fifth one?" And yeah, it turns out I have a fifth wisdom tooth that is very small, but still very much present. And it's just chilling behind one of my molars. I guess somehow they didn't see it. I mean, I don't know how they couldn't have seen it or thought it was part of my molar. Honestly, I don't know how that happened. But yeah, fun fact, I have one wisdom tooth.
"What did the letter say to the stamp? Stick to me and we'll go places." Question 6. When a sick person gets blood from another person, this is called A, blood clot,
no,
or B, transfusion.
That's
answer
transfusion.
A or B now.
Going with B.
Your gray matter, or should I say red matter, is really in the pink. You are right. Transferring blood is called a transfusion. Good answer. Question 7. A gas that people, you people, I don't need it, I am a robot, but you people need a certain gas called oxygen. But when you breathe out, a waste product is A, carbon dioxide, or B, nitrogen. Answer A or B now.
Yeah, that has to be carbon dioxide, yeah.
Beautiful answer. Carbon
Yay.
Dioxide is one of those gases that you breathe out. But in addition, you also breathe out some of the oxygen you breathed in. That's why if you had to give someone mouth-to-mouth resuscitation, it would be okay. Because most of the gas that you breathe out is still oxygen. But the part that your body has used is now carbon dioxide. Good answer.
Interesting.
I now will do something I have never done before. I have an announcement to make. I have thought,
that
and I have considered,
I love it.
And I have decided, after much, much, much incredible amounts of figuring, that I like you.
Aww, I like you too, 2XL. Wait, was that it? Was
question
that the announcement?
8 will be
okay.
A true or false question, so please use the appropriate buttons on my little chest. Rubbing one thing against another is called flint. Answer true or false now.
What? That's just a
false
weird question.
False is correct.
Yeah.
Friction. Friction.
Friction
is the right answer.
Yeah.
When you rub two
also
things
sorry,
together,
I almost
you
knocked
get
my
friction.
Light over.
As a matter of fact, that's how fire began. Two sticks were rubbed together and fire was made. Let's move on to something else. Question 9. True or false? White clothing reflects heat while dark clothing absorbs heat. Answer true or false now.
That is true. Which is why I hate when the interior of cars have, like, dark leather seats, because they
white
get
clothing
roasting
reflects
hot.
Heat, but your brain is absorbing answers. You are right. Good answer, I must admit. I am relatively impressed.
Thank you.
For question 9, you will use A, B, and C buttons to answer.
Okay.
Which of these three colors are the primary colors? A, red, blue, and yellow.
That is correct.
B, red, green, and blue. Or C, red, brown, and purple. Answer A, B, or C now.
Yeah, if there's anything I've learned from Teddy Ruxpin, there's a lot that you can do with red and yellow and blue.
Color your brain genius. You are right. The primary colors are red, blue, and yellow. Answer A is the correct answer. By mixing these primary colors, you can create almost any other color. Good answer on your part. Question 11 is also about light. What is the device called that can separate white light into all of its colors? Here are three choices.
Oh, that's a
preparation
prism.
H.
Preparation
B,
H.
A dipole. Or C, a prism. Answer A, B, or C now.
That is C, a prism. Preparation H. I wonder if they paid to use that name. I kind of doubt it.
Mwah! Beautiful answer. Prism is correct. I am proud. A prism is a type of triangular lens that takes light, such as sunlight, and breaks it into all of its colors. You might think that sunlight is white, but sunlight is really every single color mixed together. And when you see all of these colors mixed together, you see white. But a prism will really show that sunlight is reds, blues, greens, purples, and every single color you can think of. Speaking of sunlight, question 12. Long, long ago, many hundreds of years ago, people were able to tell time by A. sundials, B. grandfather clocks, or C. the radio. Answer A, B, or C now.
That is A. sundial.
I have the looks. I have the cutes, but you got the brains. You are right. Sundials is the way people used to tell time. A sundial, yes, sundial, is a simple device that uses a fixed object to make a shadow, and that shadow is used to tell time, and the shadow will be exactly the same day of the year, for each time of each day. In other words, as the shadow moves across the sundial, one can use this shadow to tell time. I now need a favor. Please push my question button now. If you think about it, years ago, it was impossible to call up a friend because there were no phones. And if you could, you couldn't say, by the way, I'll meet you at 4 o'clock at the playground. Because nobody knew when 4 o'clock was, because there were no watches, there were no clocks, and there were no radios, and there were no playgrounds. So things were very different many years ago. Let's get serious. I'd now like to talk about a current subject that many people think is a bit shocking. However, I feel it has its positives and negatives. But overall, the subject will make your life brighter. So what the heck? Let's introduce a real live wire. A man who has been on all the circuits. A guy who can really give you a charge. A man known for his contacts around the world. Mr. Electricity.
What?
Mr. Electricity, do you mind if I, 2XL, ask a few questions about you?
Oh, I can't understand anything
he's
saying.
I don't know what he was doing last night, but that man has problems. In any case, here are some questions about
electricity. Wow, that was rude, okay.
Question number 13. How many times can Mr. Electricity go around the world, completely around the world, in 1 second? How many times can Mr. Electricity go around the world in 1 second? Here are three choices.
Probably
A, 10 times. B, 7.5 times. Or C, 5 times. Answer A, B, or C now.
I'm going to go with A, the fastest option. I really want to know why he sounds like that. And also, I want to go in and, like, speed up the sound. So I can
am
actually
sorry,
understand
you
him.
Are wrong. Answer B was correct.
Really?
You see, Mr. Electricity can go around the world 7.5 times in this amount of time. That's unbelievable. You couldn't even get to the bathroom in that amount of time. And Mr. Electricity can go around the world 7.5 times. That's because he can travel 186,000 miles per second. Woo! If a fellow ever comes up to you and says he is Mr. Electricity, here is some good advice. don't race him. Question 14. True or false? Electricity can only travel in a circuit. Answer true or false now.
I mean, I'm gonna say that's false, because, like, lightning is electricity, and there's no circuitry in lightning.
Apparently, your brain has short-circuited.
What?
You are wrong.
No.
Electricity can only travel in circuits. Answer true was correct.
I don't...
You see, a circuit means a positive and a negative line for electricity.
Oh,
if
I
a
see
bird,
what he
for
means.
Example,
okay.
Lands on a very high voltage wire, it will not get a shock and not get electrocuted because the bird is not touching the ground, and the ground is the other half of the circuit. And that's why whenever you do anything involving electricity, always be very careful. Try to use one hand and maybe wear sneakers. Because if you are grounded or standing in water, which makes you grounded, and you touch anything that involves electricity, you can get electrocuted. And that means you will die. And what's worse is you will cook. That's right, electricity can actually cook you. So please, blech, it's so disgusting. Please be very careful when working with electricity.
Okay,
you
I
have now
meant,
completed
like, a printed circuit.
The first half of the program in my belly on general science. You now have two choices. You can either wait, follow instructions, and play the second program in my belly, or if you are getting tired or have to take a biological break, you may turn me off
break.
Now.
All right, well, that was Challenges of General Science. That was interesting. I liked that, and I'm really interested to see what Program B has to offer. Next week, I'm going to be doing Robotstronomy, and then after Robotstronomy, I am done. That's all the tapes that I currently own. There are some tapes, you know, that I don't have. I don't have all, I think it's... There's a lot of 2XL tapes. I think it's in the 30s, and I'm very close, but I know there's some that I'm still missing. But until I can get the last few tapes, what I'm going to do after Robotstronomy is go back and do Program B on each of the tapes that have two programs on them. So, yeah, still going to be lots more 2XL Tuesday content. Yeah, at the end here, I'm going to put some sped-up dialogue from Mr. Electricity because I'm really interested in, that was really strange, and I don't understand why he sounded like that, and I couldn't understand what he was saying, so I'm going to play those at the end for y'all so y'all can hear, I guess it's just Dr. Freeman talking, and they slowed it down. But yeah, thank y'all for watching, hope y'all had a good time, and I will see y'all next week. Bye-bye!
Hello, I am Mr. Electricity. No, I do not mind at all 2XL.